But okie dokie.
With an early finish to that run, at least relative to our usual here in terms of our Sunday stream, I feel like we do still have a bit of time to burn. We could call it exceptionally early, but we've barely been on today, all things considered. So why not jump into the next one here? Because next on our list, we do have Genie, a species I've been very excited for. They were released, was it in 0.27, I believe? Yeah, you like to see waffling up there, respect. Always got to put the respect on the Fling name. The Fling dynasty is a staple in the mythos of the game here, much like all the questions that we were just discussing. Never forget, always remember the Fling dynasty. And you love Genius Shaper? That's awesome. If you have any combos that you'd really want to see, especially if it's one of your favorite go-tos, definitely shout it out. Can even make this a bit of an ode to you here, Shaper, for all the support that you show on the channel and all the love that you've given over the months here. In fact, before we start, I think I will grab a refill for my drink. I have promised myself that I'd try my best to hydrate a little bit better over this episode than usual. And it's a nice little pause point here to step off remote. So I'll be right back in just a brief second here with a topped off drink ready to hop in with Genie. Hopefully remembering all the stats that I read just earlier today, I was thinking we might finish our run in time to start Genie. I should go to the wiki page, you know, remind myself as to what we're dealing with, all the little ifs and buts of the whole thing, but that memory, not always at its top game. So I'll be back in just a few seconds here. Don't go anywhere. And we'll be right back to hop into Genie, have some fun. See you in a sec. Shaper, you were saying Fire Elementalist and Conjurer are amazing starts, so Genie Conjurer then sounds fantastic to me. Seems like a solid start. I've really enjoyed playing Conjurers for a long time. Their starting spellbook is quite a nice blend of things that I really like taking advantage of moving forward, so sounds pretty sweet to me. And we'll get ready to head into Genie. So of course the main gimmick of the Genie species themselves is that they have no magic points and instead have magic innate in their own bodies, so we use health in replacement, I guess, to anything that would normally cost magic points. We also can't memorize spells from books, we instead just learn them innately. At every odd level, I think starting at level 3, we gain a new spell into our book, don't have to memorize anything, and instead of the traditional spell schools that you have to train between, all of Genies come down to just spell casting, so it makes things like multi-school spells a lot easier to train because you just have that one skill to upgrade for them, but it does make things a little bit more interesting in order to get all around, especially since who knows what our toolbox is going to look like once we get to the later parts of the game. Sometimes you have just the perfect synergies cropping out of nowhere, other times you have an eclectic mix of spells that you're not sure what to do with, and that's often what makes Genie, in my very limited experience with them, already one of my top favorite species to try out, because when you're pigeonholed into a box, I feel that's usually where you get to learn new things, experiment a little bit, like how we just tried out Rue for the first time, thanks to chat suggesting it, lovely. I always say lovely because that's just how I describe all you folk, but in a lovely fashion, I guess. My best example of that, or most like concrete example, is on one of the, I think two Genies that I've played. I got Yara's Violent Unraveling and Slow, two spells that I've never touched, never really messed with throughout the course of playing this game, the whole 12 years of it. And yet, because I was forced into it, I actually found that it was fairly successful. It became my go-to like Hydra killing technique early on in the run. Definitely falls off as you get to later on, but to start out, it was a really cool eye-opening lesson as to how some of these kind of niche sideline spells that are so often pushed to the side and disregarded can actually be kind of useful and fun to use too, because it was interesting to just slow things and then blow up their own negativity in their face. And yeah, I like Christina Aguilera as the name. I think that's what we'll go with here, even though Aladdin's Sane to respective Bowie or Jafar ended up a genie. I'm liking all the names. Safed always on the ball with the suggestions. But genie strat, stack regen, run at half health, spell spam is strong. Train up your spell power and fighting pretty much exclusively till they're both double digits. Makes sense. And recommended gods, Ash, Gozeg, and Mac. I mean, don't have to say Gozeg twice to me, but I think McLeb is where I was leaning towards here. It has a fun synergy with the health replenishment mechanic. The fact that the abilities from McLeb already cost health to use is kind of a fun thematic thing. In fact, in general, the thematic nature of that matchup really calls to me. So I think we'll go with that unless something early on changes our opinions. And we'll try it out. So we'll describe more of what genie actually get up to in just a moment here once we pop in. We're going with Conjurer, as suggested. And we'll go with Aladdin Sane, since that seems to have some backing behind it. Give a little bit of a shout out or piece of respect to David Bowie, which is always appreciated in my mind. And okay, let's hop in. So the main things that we want to keep in mind early on here is that we do start with some innate resistance to fire, 2 pips of that. We're also immune to poison, to miasma, so a lot of good advantages there. As a bit of a trade-off, we are vulnerable to cold. So as a being with fire flowing through our veins, we'll have to be a little bit cautious of the early white imps, stuff like that. We also have no feet because we're a shroud of magical energy from the waist down, so it allows us to fly. We won't ever wear boots. And as we mentioned, we have the innate spells that we learned from our own heritage here. Our magical power is all directly linked to our life essence instead. And this last one is a little bit of a red herring. We have superior vitality, giving us an extra 4 health. But that is also offset with the fact that I believe we're at a negative 10% HP pool. Compared to the average species, or the baseline, I should say, since I'm not sure how the numbers actually work out. So we're actually kind of in a weird middle zone between the lower health species and standard 0 point, but should definitely still come in handy. A couple of extra spells. We, of course, despite or not included in our innate learning that we get at every odd level, we do start out with the usual spell book, all fully memorized right off the bat here. Which is nice. I mean, Seer and Ray, as soon as we can throw that out. In fact, can we cast higher level spells? No, okay. That's a good confirmation to make. I didn't think so. Seemed like that might have been an odd thing to keep in. So we will be working with Magic Dart for the start here. And we will probably just be leaning into fighting and spell casting, trying to get all our spells online, and of course fighting to get our health pool, which in turn is also our magic pool, as well as just, you know, the usual thing of keeping ourselves alive. So definitely seems prudent to get training right off the bat here. Last but not least, we will set all of the usual pickups here, even stones to begin with, just in case that comes in handy. And let's get off on a roll here. Troll Leather is really strong. Makes sense, yeah, with the extra regeneration. And Gozeg makes that unlikely to happen. That's definitely fair. You get spells every odd level, indeed, yeah. You got Moon Troll Leather on a genie, what? Nice, nice. See, when those things do manage to work out, I'm gonna have to get used to the fact that we're using our health for magic too. I'm not even paying attention. I'm just like, oh, spam Magic Dart. Used to it stopping me after the initial, usually like 3 that you have with the average conjurer start. Instead, we could essentially do this indefinitely. Unfortunately, it does bring us closer to a nasty shock when we get taken out. And there's no auto stop on our macros here. So maybe I should be using the auto quiver to cast instead. That seems prudent, potentially intelligent. And same with other scales too. That's the main drawback of Gozaig. Yeah, always a bit of a pain, but of course you are getting rich in the meantime, and Gozaig has so many plus sides that I don't have too much of a problem in that regard. Gin and Tonic is a name. Gosh darn it, always comes to me too late. Hey, who knows? Maybe we won't do quite as well as I would like moving forward. Not that I would wish ill on good old Aladdin here, but we'll see what happens, eh? And we'll have to keep Gin and Tonic on the back foot for sure. That's pretty great. And yeah, with our vulnerability cold, those oozes do definitely hurt. Fortunately, they don't do a whole lot of damage. So even with the extra damage or the extra cold, not too bad. And the endoplasms aren't an issue, I guess. Confirming there. I actually thought that they did do cold damage. But I must be mixing up my oozes, which I apologize for. Each ooze is beautiful in its own right and deserves to be treated as the wonderful snowflake it is. And I, of course, also forgot that we do have Searing Ray at our disposal now. This is one of my favorite abilities, partially why I enjoy the Conjuration starting book here so much, because Searing Ray will take care of just a huge selection of your problems that you'll come across. We also, at level 3 here, got our first innate magical spell added to our book here, which ended up being Foxfire, which, hey, if that's not appropriate, I don't know what is. So I'm actually going to throw that on our Quick Quiver cast, because this is an exceptionally powerful spell for the early game. It's definitely, it was very much tempting me to go with the Fire Elementalist side when we were first starting off here, but hey, what, don't need to if we just get insanely lucky. And what kind of run would it be if we didn't immediately find magical boots on a genie? Fantastic stuff. So, hey, works out well for the karmic energies, right? As mentioned earlier, we'd be more afraid if we found the perfect piece of equipment for our character that should ensure us victory, because there's no greater way to lock in our own defeat than giving me something beautiful right off the bat. Oh, Foxfire spam is amazing. It is definitely, yeah, one of my favorite spells. There's a reason why Fire Elementalists eventually did supersede Conjurer for my favorite start. In fact, both Ice Elementalist and Fire Elementalist eventually made the cut and became my favorite go-tos, because they're slightly more thematic and they're just so powerful. Ice Elementalist a little less so than when I initially got hooked, which was in 0.25, when Ice Ramparts, Frozen Ramparts, that's what that spell's called. Frozen Ramparts was just stupidly overpowered, but even with the changes that they made to the spell, I still think it's one of the more powerful opportunities, and you can't complain about that. Fantastic stuff. And wait for 0.28 Fire Elementals, it's so good. Yeah, I really want to try some of the new spells. And I really am excited to try out the God of Cinder. I forget their name. The new god, the new saddest deity added to the game. Except I don't think I'm going to have it in me to exhaust their spark. I think Ignis is going to be constantly tempting me to never use my abilities because they don't have much power left. Who am I to use the last inkling, the last spark of my deity's power for my own selfish gains? I don't know, is it worth it? Even if we do get the orb, is it truly worth it? And was that when we could kite through it? Yeah, for Frozen Ramparts, that's exactly it. It's when you could still move and keep the spell active. Absolutely incredible stuff. Stupid powerful. And definitely a fair nerf, as it ended up being, of course. Okay, so let's head back, to an open room. Of course, we get immediately confused. I was hoping to just fill this entire arena with balls of flame. Unfortunately, game's thrown a little bit of a curveball here. Could start chugging potions. I don't feel horrible about our abilities to get through this stumbling around. Qualified Dean potions, potentially being the intelligent play, but we can just continually fill the entire corridor with Foxfires, and would you look at that, ain't no thing. We also see that we gain pass while as our next spell, so a little bit of utility being thrown into the mix now. I can respect it. We're also on our way to having Fulminant Prism and IMB castable. Is Kendaren's Mystic Blast one of my favorite spells in the game? Fulminant Prism, I keep hearing good things about it. It's such a staple of most good conjuration players, but I've definitely just never quite gone to full comfort with it, which means this might be a time to try and play this character right, because yeah, Shaper immediately mentioning in chat as well that it is so good. That's exactly the opinion I think that is shared by the majority of the community, so that's fair. I at least do understand the general idea of how to place them and stuff, not going in completely blind, so that's at the very least a solid start. And I think I'm in a decent position to figure it out. You'll find me a link here about it. That definitely works for me as well. I might not check it out right away here on stream, but I always appreciate having those things to take a look at after the fact. Especially since it's unlikely that we get through this run in its entirety with the rest of the time we have today. So we'll likely have some more time in the future to take advantage of any life lessons you can impart upon good ol' Aladdin Sane here. Put on some gloves. I mean, it's a nice orange. Definitely on brand for our sweet Fire Lord here. And we will just keep it moving. This is where I was tempted to switch over to Searing Ray just to take advantage of extended fighting, but that's a-okay. Quazlaw is also something that intrigues me anytime I see them. I think that they're such fun god to play, of course, coming with their own issues and caveats. You're going to be struggling for a large part of the game with just the sheer number of opponents coming out of the woodwork to take you down, but hey, that's fine with me. And also, Ring of Protection is a huge get on any caster early on. You love to see it. Any kind of defensive capabilities we can add on to the pile here will do a whole lot in keeping ourselves alive in the near future. As we continue on. Natasha. Okay, Natasha. Just remember that I spared you. If I end up seeing you on the orb run, just go the other direction, Natasha. Don't you even try. You mean Faded God, surely? I was so tempted. When we saw the Faded Altar on, what was that, like D1 or D2? I was so tempted. I mean, you're just begging to be given Trog when you worship at a Faded Altar with a genie, which, I mean, isn't the end of the world. Trog is such a strong god for a 3-rune game that you can actually get through in one piece. I believe that was one of the combos that was forced onto one of the main victory streakers in the game, was it not? I forget exactly who it was. I know Yermek is known for a lot of their high level play in general. Could be who? I'm sure somebody in chat has a better understanding or idea of who I might be thinking of, but it's definitely possible, even if not exactly ideal, to worship Trog as a genie. But I think we are desperately hoping to get McLeod, because I do want to just go as on brand as possible. If we only get one shot to try out Genie this with this entire stage in our great player journey here, then I'd like to go with the most iconic combo we can think of to try and give a decent representation of what one may expect. Try this out for themselves in the future. We also didn't explicitly mention it, but at level 7 we got Mephitic Cloud unlocked, which is a very nice spell for us. Not only is it exceptionally useful to be able to confuse some of the scarier enemies early on here, it also is a triple school spell, which means we get it online much earlier than one might usually expect. This is already castable, fully castable for us, essentially at 3% failure rate, so you do love to see that. And in fact, I think what we'll do right off the bat here is go equal sign S to rearrange some of our spells, and we'll switch H and C so that we have Mephitic Cloud on one of our quick cast macros here. Though, for the most part, you guessed it, we're just going to be using Foxfire for pretty much every problem the game throws at us. Until it forces me to do differently, I see no reason to change. Also, seeing all these spellbooks, tempted to change our auto pickup settings to actually grab them, because sure, they're not going to teach us anything new. It's not like we can memorize spells from a book, like a nerd. But it's always nice to read, especially when you're stuck in here for, as we determined at the end of our last run, potential decades searching through this dungeon. I mean, you gotta have some source of entertainment, right? But we'll take a quick search around. The usual caster gods aren't quite as useful as one might expect, because we, of course, don't deal with magical power whatsoever. So that's fine. Could this be the run where we actually use the staff, right? I mean, we got the Staff of Conjuration early, which is pretty wild. A lot of staff benefits, again, don't quite work out in the same ways, specifically ones that require training in the school to gain an extra effect, not as good. But in terms of amplifying the spell power of the spells that we can cast within that school, fully effective, they do their usual things, so that's pretty sweet. Now, we come to a little bit of an impasse here. No McLeb in our economical temple, unfortunately. If we really want to force it, really go for that iconic duo that cannot be beat, we could risk a couple more dungeon floors hoping that we run into a Mac Altar sooner rather than later. Alternatively, Shaper was also suggesting both the Ashen Zari and Gozeg as potential candidates for the future. New Ash, I've definitely very much appreciated in the past, especially if we can get very specific boosts on our cursed equipment. I could see that working out for us. And as I said, Gozeg, I mean, don't I know it? Greed is good. And is definitely, way to sound sure of myself, but is almost definitely my highest win rate amongst all the deities in the game. Because introspection curse stacking is very, very, very strong. Okay, that makes sense for sure. Oh, right, because you get fighting and spellcasting. Huh. That's wild. Better spells, more health? That sounds like a fun thing to try out. I think we will go with Ash. I wanted to do McLeb. Especially new McLeb, not quite as powerful as the good old days when you're able to regenerate, you know, your entire health pool by slaughtering some popcorn, but still decently compatible with our genie here, especially if we get something like Manifold Assault and we can kill off the entirety of the screen in fell swoops. That's where you're healing up your full health bar as dreamed of, but Ashen Zari seems kind of fun. So let's try it out. That also works for me, and as long as Shaper's suggesting it, I mean, this is your run, Shaper. If there's anything you want to see, just let me know, and I'll do my best to make it possible here. But okie dokie, we immediately get all of our stuff identified, which is also a pretty huge boon of following good old Ash here. And we'll pop on the Ring of Dexterity, and then we have to wait for an offer, I believe. Again, it's been a little bit, even since we did play New Ash. The to-do, unbudging God, is all-knowing and all-seeing. Of course, devoted worshippers are allowed to grasp shreds of the knowledge and foresight. Beautiful. I do believe that's similar to Rue. And it's funny that we've waited so long between Ash runs that I've actually forgotten some of the mechanics. But I believe, like Rue, we have to wait for them to be offered. And then hopefully we can take some good ones, some good shackles moving forward. And you spend a long time on figuring out how to win with Genie. Super puzzly on how you make all your skills work together. No, definitely agree with that. And as I was mentioned earlier, that's my favorite piece of the Genie experience for sure. Because I absolutely adore the puzzly aspect. Ooh. And now for you, friends, we have immunity to poison. You, unfortunately, for yourselves, fortunate for me, don't have the same advantages. A water moxin, though, is not super fun. Not exactly what I was hoping for. We do have IMB castable, so we can kind of keep them at a safe distance from us here. In fact, I might start off that way. Oops, not Fulminant Prism. I actually wanted to fail to cast IMB. Perfect. That's exactly what I meant to do, of course. Well, Mephitic Cloud to make sure those gnolls aren't causing a ruckus. And then Searing Ray should be enough to take down the Water Moccasin regardless. Fantastic stuff. Nash is so good for Megali. Yeah, we have limited experience. I believe it was on our Gnoll victory in this series that we played with Ash for the first and last time. And absolutely loved it. And here's an early White Imp. So normally, probably not too much of a struggle here on, what, like D5? D6. Okay, we were close. Again, gaming brain, specifically my dungeon crawl brain, not firing on all cylinders today. Even stuff that I've looked at multiple times, like what floor we're on right there in the top right. Completely over my head, of course. But even with our vulnerability to cold, we should be in an okay place to take down the White Imp, especially since we have fire. The Lord of Fire on our side. Fantastic stuff. And we'll continue exploring here, shall we? One of the easier runs to play one-handed, that's for sure. We just have to pretty much press O and P. And that's the entirety of necessary actions here. Absolutely beautiful. Slain, not great right now, but definitely intrigues me for the future. It's likely that we'll be going some degree of hybrid with this run. If just to make sure that we're not always losing all of our health just at the very beginning of a fight, of course. Though if we have powerful enough spells to make it worth their weight in gold, then, I mean, never say never, and I might be a fool for even suggesting it, but there we go. We get our first vision here. A boost to melee and ranged abilities. O and P are pretty close together. Exactly. That's what's saving my my life here. Making me not having to peer over my mic. Making sure I'm not hitting the wrong key, because it's always a bit of a fright when you hit the wrong key in the game here. But no such concerns today. So managed to get up to level 9 and we learn Gale's Gravitas. So this is a spell that I've never actually really used before, so I think it's worth it to take a peek. And in fact, let's open up the description here. Briefly redirects gravity around a target point, causing down to be towards that point. All nearby creatures save the caster fall helplessly towards that point, typically colliding with each other or with a victim standing there. Okay, so we can do a little bit of movement. Yeah, much like Shaper mentions, I was thinking of Mephitic Cloud and Gales as our kind of one more obvious use here. Same, I guess, with Fulminant Prisms. We can try and pull some extra victims into the blast radius. That seems pretty solid. You find Fulminant casting very strong with Genie. You rarely train weapons. However, Ash will give you all of it anyway. Indeed. No, I think we'll wait out for now. Especially since I'm not sure what we'd curse to ourselves at the moment. I guess the Ring of Armor class is the only one that immediately jumps out at me here. But for the time being, I don't mind waiting off, holding off for hopefully some of that sweet, sweet introspection that we were talking about earlier, because that does seem incredibly powerful combo. I guess like a most incredibly powerful combo on this type of character. Onwards we go. Turns out we didn't find a McLeb altar anytime soon, so I'm glad that we ended up pivoting when we did. Ooh, evocations and introspection. Ash and Zari, you shouldn't have. Let's do a quick confirmation. This is what we're looking for. That's like everything I love most in this game. Evocations and exactly the skill that we're looking for. That's a win-win. So the question becomes, what do we curse? Because I don't want to get rid of this ever, which makes the armor class ring slightly less tenable of a choice because it's likely to be changed out for some kind of artifact in the future, maybe some kind of resistance instead. But I guess by then we will ideally have a bunch of introspection at our back and have the room to wiggle a little bit, to maneuver and get it back in the future. So let's curse item, let's get started here, shall we? That Ring of Protection is at least sticking around for the near future.
at least for quite some time here. One of the only resistances that we're even really looking for. Oops. Let's not try and fight an orc warrior. You know what? You can't kill me in one hit, I believe, right? 15 plus a dire flail. Ooh, it's closer than I'd like, but... Okay, please. Sir? How are you? Okay, there we go. Now you're confused. Get absolutely wrecked. Not a doubt in my mind. Let's put down another mephitic cloud here, and then... Okay, I know we're too injured to cast, but come on. Let me just fill the air, please. Gonna see some red flashes here, of course, as we get ourselves near death. Also, oh right, Sky Beast right next to us. I probably actually deserve to die to that one, but get absolutely wrecked instead. Okay, fantastic. Hopefully we survive long enough to try out the old Fulminant Prism Gale's Gravitas, eh? I mean, technically we could have done it now, so we could have even checked out the efficacy pulling the Orc Warrior into the Noxious Fumes. Was a potential option there that managed to slip my mind in its entirety, but hey, we lived to another day here, and hopefully we'll be fine moving forward. So you, friend, do corrosive damage. You just do steam, which honestly, not even slightly concerning. The bite and the clawing, a little bit more so, don't get me wrong, but definitely don't have to worry about that. So maybe this is a good opportunity to try out Fulminant Prism. So I think something like this seems like a decent placement. And then on top of that, oh, I can't see there. That's fine. That's gonna hit me. Bring everyone like this. Does that work? Kinda. Searing Ray to add on our own essence here. Fantastic. So definitely worked out in that specific encounter. I don't know how all-encompassing or generalized we can make that, because it was maybe not the strongest setup of monsters and could have easily been dealt with the old-fashioned way, but that's generally, I guess, when you want to practice with things, right? When you want to experiment. Right, I forgot that things became artifacts when we cursed them. Curse Ring of Aporomancy. Aporomancy? The way these sounds formulate in my head, I can't help but split it into like Aporomancy. That's pretty romancy. But let's switch off our Ring of Dexterity for Evasion, because that's pretty much the only reason why we were wearing the Dex Ring anyway, is to try and get some more evasion under our belt. Everything's still looking good in terms of skill training. I'm not too concerned about stretching ourselves between. Instead, we'll just keep going with what we've got here. Oh, bees. Oh, gosh, not the bees. But... actually, in all honesty, probably exactly the type of fight we'd like to face at this stage. One of the rare species that have that innate poison resistance that make bees a completely different fight from what you would otherwise face, I guess, on your average character. Your last six wins were with Ash Ugly. You're worried it's going to get nerfed soon. Yes, always the concern. As soon as something starts to go too well, you gotta be worried that it's gonna be on the ban block. I know, but they even tried to nerf Gozeg at one point, right? I think when Gozeg was first introduced, they were even stronger than they currently are. Nerfed them a little bit and still not even close to being an issue here. Let's see, so we get Cunning and Fortitude. So Cunning is dodging and shield armor, or dodging and stealth, and some armor and shield. So we could get all the defensive skills in one fell swoop here. Especially if we just take this as a bit more of a temporary curse. Maybe curse our Ring of Evasion. We could curse our staff. That seems kind of wild. Ash was nerfed in 0.28 in a big way, or anything too debilitating, I guess, moving forward. Because Gozeg is just as strong as Ash. Now, again, you might be talking to someone that's a little bit biased, but in my personal style of play, I find Gozag to be probably the most powerful deity in the dungeon here. There's just so much flexibility brought in with a ingrained way to have consumables, I guess, is where we're going. Instead of having to rely on getting all the potion stacks that you need to survive in the middle to late game, just pay for them on the spot. Just absolutely spam the crap out of potion petition. And at the end of the day, that's just the tip of the iceberg, because you, of course, can also bribe branches, which by the time you get to Zot becomes stupidly powerful. Just bribe the entirety of what is supposed to be the hardest branch in the game, and instead, you can kind of just cakewalk your way through it. Ain't no thing, not a care in the world. At least if you're lucky. We've had our fair share of less fortuitous events, to say the least. But hello, Prince Rivet. I don't believe you're poison immune, so we will just blast you. Goodbye, Prince Rivet. It was nice to meet you. A little disappointing, maybe, but hey. Can't expect everyone to be as strong as our godly genie, right? That just wouldn't be fair. So we'll just keep using a mix of Mephitic Cloud and Searing Ray to take care of this lovely lot. I actually very much expected Gozag, or not Gozag on the brain, but to get our entrance to Lair is what I was going for there. Ooh, and now this gets tough. Slimes are exceptionally scary to find this early on. Large slime creature, 120 health, absurd. Absolutely no good. 44 damage, also, oof, not great. So, we probably should just run away here. It's bad how tempted I am to push through it. Biostan? Hey, nobody does it quite like Bio. At least with the rest, you know, you have to, like, weigh them out. It's comparing apples with maybe pears or something like that. But Bio and any other deity, apples and oranges, my friend. Nothing compares. Which is as it should be, because when you're playing as the Messiah of Bio, you wanna feel special. Nobody does it quite like Bio themselves. Okie dokie, another pack of yaks surprising us at the bottom of the stairs. Not fantastic. Ash was nerfed to needing one pip of beauty to get the free ID and trap saving. That definitely seems to make sense. Especially if you find like a D2 Ash, it's such a huge advantage just to get your inventory ID'd. Absolutely fantastic to be able to get those potions exactly when you need them instead of just blindly quaff ID'ing left and right as soon as you find yourself in dire straits. Oh, and there's the McLeod altar that we were looking for earlier. That's nice. What the heck is even that? We get introspection and evocation combo again. Well, shafts were nerfed 2.8, only one shaft per branch in the game. Yeah, I heard about that. I'm very interested. I mean, personally, I've always been a huge fan of shafts. Even if they get me killed and there's nothing I could have done about it, just kind of makes me chuckle to myself. And when I manage to, you know, struggle through adversity and push my way through an unfortunate shafting, I feel absolutely alive and fantastic. So, I definitely was never a huge opponent to the shafts, but I still think that that does make sense for sure as a change, especially for certain branches of the game. Getting shafted multiple times can be an absolute, just kind of annoying experience. It makes it very interesting for the standard dungeon because you got 15 floors that you can normally get shafted on each and every one, and you're telling me that don't have to worry about any of that? It's a dream come true. Let's switch over. I think we have two Curare darts, so I don't mind using those up against an Ogier here. And what do we do with you? I could just throw down like Fulminant Prism right here, right? Oh gosh, they stepped into the poison. What the heck are they doing? They ruined my Fulminant. Okay. Oh, I'm using Mephitic Cloud, that's why. It turns out I'm slightly brain dead, very dumb. Fantastic. Okay, that's quite powerful.
Can we enchant the gloves at all? That could be good cursing.
We can. So that is something, in fact, let's get back on track here before I forget about this curse and it gets shuffled out. Gloves would be a decent one because they're unlikely to be changed out anytime soon here. Staff is tempting, but also a recipe for disaster. I mean, sure, we're long past the days of binding a blunt weapon to your hands and starving to death because you can't cut up corpses. But we still might want to be able to switch to a different weapon at some point in our future. So let's go with the gloves. Seems pretty fantastic. And Shinzari will now reveal the unseen. Fantastic. Oops. Use Kurari darts. I actually should switch this back to Foxfire. There we go. Fantastic. Make sure we don't accidentally make that mistake too many times, or we will end up mulching all of our favorite survival darts here. And you, friend, can please walk right this way once you're next to us. Not exactly a threat. Fantastic stuff so far. We're also in an ideal little cubby hole for Foxfire in order to let the shots stream on past. Fantastic stuff. And onwards we go. So yeah, we're already seeing huge boosts to our fighting and spell casting, which is fantastic. I guess evocations as well, but don't get much of a boost when you have absolutely zero training. But maybe this is at least a time to get some thought-provoking ideas out there. Do we have any reason to train evocation, for example? No, we just have a wand of digging. Not exactly indicative of a turn to evocations anytime soon. Brain, again, struggling to come up with some basic sentence structure to try and convey what we were going for there, but we maybe got there eventually. We got somewhere. And hello, friends. For all of you, let's throw down a fulminant prism just in the back here, and then Gale's gravitas. Make sure we pull everyone into the blast. Excuse me. No one's allowed to leave. Nobody comes in or out. Fantastic stuff. And now for the last couple demon buddies here. Do it the old-fashioned way. Blast the new kingdom come. Fantastic stuff. Lots of kobolds this floor. Year of the Kobold is at hand or something. Fantastic. Evo's good with the staff too. That is true. What do conjuration staffs even do? If we're skilled in evocation conjuration, they can blast those they strike with pure energy, dealing irresistible damage. So that's pretty sweet. I mean, unfortunately, as Schaefer mentions here, we can't get the conjuration buff to this, but the evocation side, you're definitely right, Eggly, is a good thing to keep in mind at the very least. That's a lot of fun.